Right now on WLKY, should David Kam be released on bond, and where will he stand trial for a third time? A live report from the courthouse is coming up.
We've got to do a lot more, and we're going to have two very clear choices in this election.
But first, we're live with an interview you won't see anywhere else, an exclusive one-on-one with President Obama, plus a tour of the White House. Good evening to you. I'm Rick Van Hoos.
And I'm Natasha Collins. WLKY is the only media organization in Kentucky granted an interview with the president.
Vicki Dortch just wrapped up that interview. She's now live with us from the White House in quite a busy and impressive day, I would imagine, Vicki.
It certainly has been. Hi, Rick and Natasha. We've had quite a day here. I'm coming to you from live from the White House on the Northwest Lawn. I'm on Press Row, which they refer to here as Pebble Beach. Earlier today, I was in the East Room of the White House when the president announced his proposal to extend the tax cuts to the middle class. And then late this afternoon, I had the opportunity for a one-on-one exclusive interview with the president in the cabinet room next door to the Oval Office.
Mr. Obama, we heard you say that we want an economy where we work hard and we get ahead.
Right.
People in Kentucky are angry. They want change. They don't have their job. They're losing their jobs. Mm-hmm. They're not getting paid enough. The unemployment rate in Kentucky is 8.6%, higher than the national average. Mm-hmm. What can you do in the next 4 years to change this? Why should we reelect you?
Well, first of all, obviously, everybody around the country was impacted by the worst financial crisis and the worst recession we've seen since the Great Depression. And you know, we've made some progress, 4.4 million new jobs, 500,000 manufacturing jobs, but we've got to do a lot more. And we're going to have two very clear choices in this election. You've got one approach, which is let's have another $5 trillion tax cut on top of the Bush tax cuts and eliminate regulations, and somehow that's going to grow the economy and increase people's incomes. I don't think people are persuaded that's going to work because we tried it before I came into office. I think the other alternative is a process where we invest in education. We make sure that we're investing in American-made energy, that we are continuing to provide tax breaks to companies that create jobs here in the United States as opposed to ship jobs overseas, and we've got a tax code that's fair. So the announcement I made today, for example, about making sure that 98% of Americans get the assurance that their taxes aren't going to go up. Something that Republicans say they agree with me on, and then after the election, deciding what we're going to do about tax breaks for folks like me who don't really need them. I think that's the kind of choice that people are going to be looking at in this election, and I think ultimately the vision I'm putting forward is better for the people of Kentucky, better for the people of America.
All right, you'll see more of my interview with the president tonight at 6 o'clock. Rick?
Vicki, your overall impression of being at the White House today and getting to meet the president?
Oh, Rick, it's been overwhelming. We walked in at 7 o'clock this morning, and you get the impression of it's so historic, it's so overwhelming, you get goosebumps, but you cannot, it's a well-oiled machine. You have to have a permission to do anything in the White House. The White House staff, though, is very nice, very kind, and very helpful. It's been quite a day. I've got lots of stories to tell you.
Well, we can't wait to hear all of those. And the president, you were hitting him with some pretty hard questions there, but did you ever get to talk to him about just some maybe our basketball teams around here? I know he's a big basketball fan.
He certainly is. Yes, when they were micing me up, we had some chit-chat time there. And I said, you've got UofL, Kentucky, IU, all type 5 preseason picks. Who are you going to go with? And he thought a minute, and he said, well, he'd like to see Calipari's recruiting class, but he was certain that Louisville would have a good season as well. So he kind of hedged on that, did not give me an answer, didn't pick a team.
All right. Thank you, Vicki. He's the ultimate politician. Thank you so much. We look forward to hearing more from your interview with the president.
Officers rushed to a home on 32nd Street where they found two victims dead, a third injured, a fourth was found a short distance away.
And the scene drew a series of onlookers, and then tempers flared as an argument between two women led to more gunfire, ending with one of them dead and police opening fire on the shooter. Good evening to you. I'm Rick Van Hoos.
I'm Vicki Dortch. We have team coverage tonight. WLKY's Daniel Kemp spoke with family members of one of the victims.
But Marissa Alter was the first reporter on the scene. She's live at 32nd and Kentucky Streets to explain how this all unfolded. Marissa?
Rick, a sad and violent day here in Louisville's West End, which has left many in the neighborhood still in shock. It was a fatal shooting here on 32nd in Kentucky that first brought police. While they were searching for answers, gunfire broke out again, and the fatalities rose once more.
Please.
Emotions run high as afternoon violence erupts in the 1000 block of 32nd Street. Four men are shot, two fatally, their bodies covered by sheets as friends, family, and neighbors look on. Another shooting victim is rushed to the hospital with life-threatening injuries. Investigators say the fourth victim drove off and was found by 26th and Elliott. Police tell us he's expected to survive.
It was a very tragic situation. Let's get with that first.
Tragic, but brazen too, occurring in broad daylight.
Obviously, during the middle of the day, you don't expect things to happen like this, but it has today, and it's very unfortunate.
Just how and why it happened isn't known. Police can't confirm if the victims lived here and if one is also the shooter.
We're looking for a lot of things at this stage. I don't want to get definitive on anything at this point. Again, we have several detectives, several officers that are trying to get information from several different individuals at this point.
As they try to piece things together, more violence. Gunshots ring out again around 2:30. People scream and run. Officers draw their weapons. And this area, already suffering, is hit with another wave of chaos.
Hello.
And this is a live look from the WLKY News Chopper. You can see this is still an active crime scene roughly 5 hours after that first shooting. Still, a lot of questions remain. And I can tell you that the police chief and Louisville's mayor are set to address the media at 7 o'clock, talking about their plans for this area. Reporting live in the West End, Marissa Alter, WLKY News.
All right, thank you, Marissa. Now, more gunshots rang out as officers converged on the neighborhood. One woman died, another was wounded by police.
WLKY's Daniel Kemp spoke with family members. He's live at 32nd and Greenwood. Daniel?
Well, Rick, right now, police are not saying whether or not these two incidents are related, but a family member of the victim here at this location says that that victim, as well as one of the male victims in that previous shooting, did share a child together. Take a listen.
Then we got a phone call saying that such and such had got shot. So one of them is her baby's father, Tyson. She came down here to see what was going on. The next thing you know, she's laying down with the sheet over her body.
Well, Takiya Anderson, that woman you just heard from there, says she is the victim's cousin. Police tell us she was killed following some sort of altercation with another woman earlier today here at 32nd and Greenwood. Now, when the woman shot the victim, we're told an officer nearby fired on that shooter. She was taken to University Hospital. At this hour, her condition is unknown. The victim, whose name has not been released, died here at the scene.
There's too many black-on-black crimes are killing each other for no apparent reason. She's 22 years old, man. She's 22 years old, dude. I swear, man.
Too many young people are dying.
They took my cousin
too many young
from me.
Y'all need to get out of here. Y'all need to get jobs. Y'all need to take care of one another. Stop the violence.
Now, as standard procedure goes, that officer will be placed on paid administrative leave. Meanwhile, the Louisville Metro Police Chief says there will be a heavy presence out here in the nights and the weeks to come. Out here live in West Louisville tonight, I'm Daniel Kemp, WLKY News.
Stay in that basement. If you're watching from Hart County, stay in that basement for a while longer. If you're watching from Marion County as well, because still these storms showing signs of rotation and certainly capable of producing some large hail and maybe even a funnel cloud, even a tornado touchdown at a very short moment's notice.
Chopper, can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead.
What are you seeing up there? It looks like some major damage. Which direction are you looking right now?
Well, we're looking back towards the west from downtown Henryville back towards I-65. That's the, right now, I believe we're looking at the, no, he's back towards the school. That's actually right in the middle of town. Mike, if you'll pull the camera back towards I-65, which is to your right. I got to tell you, Jay, we've been doing this for a long time. Just started my 15th year with the station, and I have never seen damage like this before in my life. This is some of these super tornadoes that we always hear about other places where it just comes in and levels things down to the ground. We're going to continue to come up to the truck stop here, and I'm telling you, there's just nothing to that truck stop here. It's just all the way down to the ground. Every semi, it looks like, in this parking lot is on their side. Mike, if you'll go a little bit further to your right, towards the interstate, you just see that what we're looking at with our naked eye. Look at these semis just totally turned over on their sides right here. Just unbelievable the damage.
Now, let's go to the Doppler Network. Let's do a recap. Take a look at what we were viewing on the Doppler Network. We're going to go back in time here. Here we are about 2:30. this afternoon, and these were the huge pair of supercellular storms that we were tracking. As Vicki mentioned, these things formed out in southern Illinois earlier today during the morning hours, moved north of Evansville, put down tornadoes. Well, here we are about, what is that, about 2:55, almost 3 o'clock, the lead supercell storm passing over Pekin, creating just a ton of damage there. That was when the report came in that this storm was about a half mile wide and a multiple vortex tornado. It moved due off to the east-northeast, and that's when Jared looked at me and said, oh my gosh, it's heading right for my community. And sure enough, moved right over Henryville, Indiana, and you can see how wrapped up that storm was. This looks like the storms you might have gone on YouTube, you might have seen them in pictures from years past, the storms down south last year, the storms that hit Moore, Oklahoma years ago. That is as classic as a supercellular storm that you can get, a tornado-producing storm, and these are the types of storms that hit here today. The first storm continued to move off to the northeast, went over Marysville, went over Hanover, creating just a ton of damage there, fatalities, unfortunately. And then the second supercellular storm pretty much tracked over the same locations. This one, fortunately, did not put down a tornado along its path, at least across northern portions of Clark County. But what it did do is put down baseball to softball size hail. Talk about getting a tornado that just ruins your community. And guess what? 15, 20 minutes later, here comes another one and pounds you with softball size hail. That's what the folks in Clark County had to deal with.
It's total chaos. It's unreal. It's unreal. It's like this place has been bombed or something.
Right now on WLKY News at 11, at least 18 people are dead. Several towns flattened, homes gone, families in shock. A massive tornado tears a destructive path. The wide funnel cloud caught on video and by cameras before making its devastation known.
It sounded like a big roar, sounded like the roof was coming off. Just a lot of high wind. Sounded like a big roar.
This is what is left behind. Miles and miles of wood and walls and worry. Panicked people running for help, searching for loved ones, trying to come to grips with the scene now right in front of them.
A local high school demolished. Standing right in front, there is damage. Nearly everywhere you look, everywhere you turn, something is smashed, someone is in shock.
We have a lot of search and rescue. We do have people injured here. Fortunately, all the kids at the school heard the tornado warning. They got in the center hallway.
There are countless crushed cars, buses, and semis overturned. This school bus ripped right off its frame, then slammed right into a building. A sawmill reduced to rubble. A fire station flattened.
I don't even know what to think, man. I've never seen a tornado tear something apart like that.
Good evening to you. I'm Rick Van Hoos.
I'm Vicki George. Even with warnings and high-tech tracking, it's still impossible to prepare for the damage a tornado can do.
And tonight, twisters in Kentucky and Indiana, the toll is 19, and that will continue to grow, folks. I guarantee that. There are 14 deaths in southern Indiana, 4 in Washington County in the town of New Pekin, 4 in Jefferson in the town of Chelsea, 3 in Scott, 1 in Clark, that's in Henryville, 2 in Ripley County, and in Kentucky there are 4 deaths in Menifee County in eastern part of the state, and 1 in Kenton near Cincinnati, and there are reports that there were 4 or 5 down in the London area, but those are unconfirmed, so that's why I said it will continue to go up, we would imagine. Some of the most dramatic damage is 20 miles north of Louisville in Henryville, Indiana.
That's where the high school took a direct hit. Emergency personnel there held a news conference not long ago. WLKY's Daniel Camp begins our team coverage with what they said. Daniel?
Yeah, Vicki, we really are in the heart of the damage, and you can't help but feel for these people. Whole neighborhoods, complete communities are now gone. We are told many are injured. Some are dead. Now tonight, Indiana State Police confirm multiple fatalities in Scott, Washington, and Clark counties, and countless are hurt. Now the area has been declared a state of emergency, and patrols will be out all night covering hundreds of miles of county roads. They are going door to door, making sure people are okay and looking for the missing. Police tell us it's exactly unclear how many are still unaccounted for.
Right now, we're actively searching. You know, this, and when I say we're searching, this could go on, we know, to this time tomorrow, even maybe longer. And we will not quit searching until we are completely satisfied that there is not one single person out there that needs help.
Now, for much of the day, there was a shelter set up at Charlestown High School. Police tell us tonight that it has since moved to the Country Lake Estates. That's just outside of Henryville and is a warm place for folks to go. State police tell us it has hundreds of beds and electricity. Those are certainly necessities folks will now need who have been left with nothing.
It's devastating.
The damage evident.
Probably the worst thing I've ever seen.
The stories the same.
School's gone, houses are gone, stores are gone, neighbors, they're gone.
Ben White's home is about the only thing somewhat standing on North Front Street, an area riddled with broken trees, broken cars, and broken spirits.
I moved from one small town to another and there's nothing left of it.
It's like what you would see in the movies. It's not real until you see that funnel cloud coming towards you.
Something Erica Jennings experienced firsthand.
And I looked up and there it was. I mean, right in front of me.
She was challenged with getting 11 kids to safety when the tornado came down right next to her West Clark school bus.
I tried to turn it around. I couldn't get it turned around, so I just drove the bus through a field and we got to the nearest house we could and got in the basement.
Still, there are injuries and there are fatalities.
What we are hearing is multiple fatalities.
In a community where cleaning up won't finish anytime soon.
I hope people keep all these families in their prayers because they're going to need a lot of prayers.
If you love the small town life, you stick together with your neighbors in the community and you rebuild it.
And state police again tell us tonight at that press briefing just about an hour or so ago that anyone who needs to can now go to the Monroe Township Fire Department for transportation to any of those shelters now open. They can also go there to tell police about anyone who is still missing. Live in Henryville tonight, I'm Daniel Kemp at WLKY News.
All right, thank you, Daniel. WLKY's Jessica Oh has been in Henryville since this afternoon.
She's focusing on the heavy damage to the high school tonight. Jessica?
Rick, since earlier today, this place has been absolute chaos, and it still is to some extent. Now, if you take a look behind me, that is Henryville High School where the lights are right now. There are crews still out there. They are digging through the rubble just to make sure that no one is out there. Now, earlier today, we saw parents screaming for their children. There are school buses overturned. Once again, that high school has been absolutely leveled. So you can only imagine what it was like as a parent or a loved one to know your kid might be inside that school.
Whoa. I'll tell you one more time, I'm going to put you in handcuffs. Understand that. We're going to make sure we're safe. We got power lines down, we got gas down. The last thing I need you heard.
When a deadly tornado hits your kid's school, there are a few things many parents wouldn't do to know their kids are safe, especially when the school's left looking like this.
I'm just seeing total destruction here. I went down to school to make sure my sister was all right because my sister, she was in this building when it collapsed.
Tell me what you're seeing over here. Is this just chaos?
It's total chaos. It's unreal. It's unreal. It's like this place has been bombed or something. It's terrible.
Crews initially got reports indicating some students were trapped, but we're told it appears that's not the case.
We think right now, let me put this, we think we have all of the children safe. We think. Obviously, you know what I'm saying, we're still in the search mode and we're still in a mode where people are coming up asking for their loved ones.
Meanwhile, dozens of students are checking out what used to be their school, disbelieving the widespread damage that happened in a matter of minutes.
I can't believe it. Like, our school has always been there and it's gone. I was just in it like yesterday and it's gone. How am I supposed to go to BioAP? That's my favorite class. I just want to graduate, and most kids my age like hate school, but I love school and I like learning, and now I can't learn.
What used to be a high school now reminds students and the community of chaos and devastation.
What's it like seeing a high school look like this?
Oh, I just don't have no words for it because, I mean, I can't believe it happened.
It seems as though we're right in the middle of it. It seems though that this area here was the heart of all the damage.
And of course, at this point, it is too early to tell where these students will now be going to school as crews are still out there right now making sure everyone is safe. Reporting live at this school in Henryville, I'm Jessica Oh, WLKY News.
We'll be right back.
boxing rivals meeting on this stage. And it's all about how you respond and perform and execute within this 40-minute space that's about to tip off now. These coaches, they go way back, and all kinds of emotion tied to this one when these two meet on this kind of stage. Oh my goodness! And the Kentucky coronation is complete. Champions 2012.
Good evening, I'm Vicki George. The Kentucky Wildcats have captured their eighth national championship. You just watched the game live here on WLKY. We have team postgame coverage. Daniel Kemp is live in Lexington, but let's send it to Rick and Fred first, live in New Orleans. Guys, your perspective. I thought it got a little too close there at the end.
Yeah, I got a little scary there. They took care of business in the first half, and that was all they needed. Vicki, look at the Superdome behind us. UK national champs. That's the eighth time. The 14-year drought is over. Kentucky hangs another banner. John Calipari becomes the fifth UK coach to win a national championship.
Angels and stars, hear them on the radio, got them on the stereo. Angels and stars, reaching too far, listening to radical, now we need a miracle, yeah. Angels and stars, hear them on the radio, got them on the stereo. Angels and stars, reaching too far. Diamonds in the starlight, written in the stars, right? Angels and stars. Angels and stars. Angels and stars. Angels and stars.
And you are looking at a live picture from the WLKY News Chopper high above the KFC Yum Center, where teams still in the tournament have been practicing today ahead of the round of 32 tomorrow.
It's interesting about this team right now, guys, that UK basketball, I mean, a lot of teams would be thrilled just to make the Sweet 16, and certainly the Cats would be if they win tomorrow night at 7:45, but they're thinking very big picture. They have their eyes set on New Orleans. Nothing less than a Final Four is going to make these guys happy and obviously jump start to the national championship.
Should taxpayers be getting the bill to defend a prosecutor against allegations that he crossed the line?
It's a question at the center of a WLKY investigation. Dwayne Pullman uncovered the bills and the controversy. And Dwayne, we heard a little bit of it. You were trying to get some answers from the prosecutor himself, huh?
That's right. But as you're about to see, he didn't really want to talk to me. That prosecutor is Keith Henderson, who was at the center of one of the most famous criminal cases in our area, David Kam. But Henderson now faces an ethics complaint, writing a book about the very case he was prosecuting. Now taxpayers are paying for the prosecutor's problem.
The commission president defends it.
I will support Keith Henderson.
Others oppose it.
If they made the decision to go ahead and pay him regardless, that's beyond me.
It is a decision to use taxpayer money to defend Keith Henderson, the Floyd County prosecutor, against an ethics complaint triggered by his book deal. In a minute,
can you tell me why you can't answer questions about this?
You'll hear what the prosecutor has to say. But first, a quick look at how we got here. In 2006, Prosecutor Henderson had just gotten murder convictions against David Kam, the former Indiana trooper accused of killing his wife and children. Fresh off his victory, Henderson privately signed this contract to write a tell-all book. But the case wasn't over. Kam's verdict was overturned. Henderson canceled his book contract and returned an advance check. But the damage was done.
It's all about the book.
The defense made motions to remove Henderson from the case, claiming the prosecutor had a conflict.
What's my conflict, that I'm going to prosecute him harder?
After fighting it, an Indiana appeals court ruled against Henderson, stating the prosecutor did have a clear and convincing conflict and ordered Henderson be removed from the case. Meanwhile, in a separate and more personal allegation, an ethics complaint was filed with the Indiana Disciplinary Commission that Henderson crossed the line as an attorney. To defend himself, Henderson hired this law firm in Indianapolis. These are the actual bills: $375 an hour, $10,000 in counting. The prosecutor submitted it all to commissioners, who approved it and sent the bill to taxpayers. And that, attorneys tell us, is just plain wrong.
Had it been me, I would have never asked for reimbursement.
It gives us a black eye lawyer-wise. I'm upset by it.
While the president of the Floyd County Commissioners stands by the decision to pay for Henderson's defense, he admits he should have asked more questions.
What I can say is I would scrutinize a little bit harder.
I repeatedly tried to talk to Henderson, an elected and very public figure, but he wouldn't even return my calls. So I finally met the prosecutor, Dwayne Allman, in a parking lot.
Can you tell me why you can't answer questions about this?
About what?
About what I've been asking about the reimbursement and the request for reimbursement on the ethics complaint.
I think it's already been answered by the commissioners.
Okay, but you have it, and you're the one who made the request.
I didn't make a it's already been granted.
Right, but the request was made by you, and what I'm trying to figure out is what rationale you have for an ethics complaint that appears to be personal rather than...
You know what? I don't know you. You've left a threatening message up on
That's
the...
That's awful strong language.
Up on the message in the machine.
What's
I've
the
had a good I've had a good relationship with the media, but I don't talk to reporters who leave messages of threatening the county prosecutor.
So it has nothing to do with the issue of answering the question?
Now, as for the threat the prosecutor is referring to after repeated calls went unanswered, I left a voicemail with him telling him that as an elected public official, I needed to talk to him about the issue.
Melagnato is known as the man who got away with murder. The FBI documents show the investigation took agents and police down many paths, even to Hong Kong. 550 pages on the disappearance of Brenda Sue Schaefer. That's what we received after filing a Freedom of Information request with the FBI. The documents make it clear, from the start, Melvin Henry Ignato was the prime suspect. Scott Cox is a former federal prosecutor.
He was a narcissist. Obviously, he was a sociopath. He had no conscience at all.
Ignato killed his 36-year-old ex-fiancée with chloroform at this home on Poplar Level Road, September 24, 1988. But before taking her life, he tied Schaefer to a glass-top coffee table. Cox says Ignato was meticulous in his planning.
He took a Yale legal pad out, and he wrote down the sequence of events from, you know, planning the murder to raping her and sexually abusing her and photographing it.
Ignato's accomplice, Marianne Shore, took the photos. The two placed Schaefer in a plastic bag, neatly folded her clothes in another bag, and buried the bags in a shallow grave they dug weeks earlier. Missing was thousands of dollars in jewelry Schaefer had with her. The body wasn't discovered for another 14 months. During that time, the FBI worked the case as a possible kidnapping. According to these documents, the investigation took agents to the Miami area where Ignato had business dealings and to Southeast Asia. Ignato often traveled to Hong Kong.
We would hear rumors that maybe he had been involved in a sex crime in Asia.
Federal agents received numerous tips. One from the Kentucky Attorney General suggested Ignato was a major drug dealer. Another said he took a trip to the Orient to pick up $100,000 in cash.
I can say
Ed Armento is a former FBI agent.
In cases like this, no stone is left unturned. Every lead was followed, even leads from psychics.
One psychic claimed Schaefer was abducted by two men, and one had been hiding in the back seat of her car, which was found abandoned on Interstate 64 near Breckenridge Lane.
The FBI records show Ignato told one of Schaefer's brothers he wanted to be left alone in his ex-fiancée's bedroom at this St. Matthew's home so he could pick up some, quote, vibrations about where she might be. Thinking Ignato was going to plant jewelry or take some key piece of evidence, agents secretly planted a surveillance device in that bedroom. But for the investigators, it was another dead end, and there were many. Ignato shared this home with his mother. Law enforcement officers twice obtained search warrants.
It was just sheer luck because those searches were very intrusive. They were intrusive to the point where the police took off covers, off light switches and electrical outlets, and they did as thorough a search as they possibly could.
But Ignato's luck was about to run out.
We were able to at least have some degree of justice in the case.
Federal agents were also interested in whether Ignato had ties to the Soviet Union. The smoking gun evidence against Ignato was eventually discovered, but too late for the murder trial.
Each night, the images of violent crime play out on our screen.
But a silent killer is claiming many more lives right here in Kentucky. WLKY investigative reporter Dwayne Pullman begins an important series, Suicide on Hold. He joins us now with a look at this growing problem, Dwayne.
Yeah, suicide is now one of the leading causes of death, no matter where you are. In Kentucky, a person is three times more likely to kill him or herself than die at the hands of someone else. But at the very time suicide is on the rise, a key lifeline is in trouble. Tonight, close up with a father and stepmother dealing with the consequences of suicide on hold.
When you've lost a child, everything is different. The way you look at life, the way you look at yourself, the way you look at God.
On the 2nd Street Bridge,
nothing prepared us for this.
William and Wanda Jackson of Louisville retrace their son Chancey's final journey.
That day he felt like he didn't have a chance.
Still immersed in the pain of what happened here nearly 13 years ago.
This is where I believe our son gave up his battle.
On the way to this bridge, Chancey had a rough road.
He had a tough life, a young life.
He was abused at 5. Rescued by his father, Chancey adjusted, but was never considered a cool kid.
He was definitely bullied.
In the months before he died, Chancey, then 18, began seeing a girlfriend, secretly giving her thousands of dollars.
He was an 18-year-old virgin. He did not know what he was doing. And
on July 12, 1999, the day he died, Chancey's secret girlfriend walked away.
She broke up with him on that day.
Even worse, Chancey crashed the family car.
It was just like everything crashing in.
Instead of calling for help, Chancey walked 3 miles to this bridge and jumped more than 80 feet into the Ohio River and death below.
I always wondered, how did Chancey do it? Did he put his leg up on the rail and think about it? Or did he just do it impulsively all at once?
In the years since Chancey leapt to his death, the number of people committing suicide in Kentucky has been steadily climbing above the national average to the highest level in 15 years. According to the Kentucky Violent Death Reporting System, suicide is by far and away the most common type of violent death in Kentucky, with nearly 2,900 reported in just 5 years. In Jefferson County, suicides jumped from 72 in 2009 to 103 in 2011. Tragically, as the number of suicides grow, this key crisis line is facing its own crisis. At the Hope Now hotline,
what kind of help are you looking for?
Funding has been cut, and a disturbing number of desperate calls for help
could be a dangerous situation
are being placed on hold.
Hold on, please.
There are quite a few calls that are on hold. It's very distressing. Very, very distressing.
back on the bridge.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
The Jacksons say a prayer.
He leadeth me beside the still waters.
And send a message.
Dear Chancy, we love you and miss you so much. And that will never stop. Dad and Wanda.
To a son.
God bless Chancy.
Who in a moment of crisis.
Well, you can't control where it goes, can you?
Leapt from their arms forever.
Isn't that beautiful? That sky is so beautiful. Gone but not forgotten.
Are you the same man you were 12 years ago?
I'm really not sure who I am at this point. I have yet to figure that out. Right now, it's just about getting through each day.
How do you keep it together?
Well, I'm not sure that I always do. But, I mean, I've always had hope. I've always believed, ultimately, that the truth would prevail. You find strength in that. I've always believed on the issues that we've raised that have caused these reversals, that we were right. So, you know, you just, it's really a survival mode.
So you go deep inside.
I don't know where I go, but I do whatever I have to do to get through each day.
For David Camp, the former Indiana State Trooper who has spent more than a decade behind bars, getting through means integrating as an inmate. He's gotten two tattoos, one he wouldn't show us.
It's a crown of thorns and three nails.
The other, the names Kim Bradley and Jill wrap around his bicep. The wife and two small children he's accused of killing in the fall of 2000.
You think about them every day?
I dream about them every night.
At the time of the horrific murders, Cam, who had resigned only months before as an active trooper, quickly became the prime suspect.
What is that like, being on the other side now?
It's a nightmare. And it's a double nightmare because I'm here for something that I didn't do.
You were a trooper. Were you a good one?
I think so, yes, sir.
Well respected?
Sure.
A tight-knit community?
Very tight, yes, sir.
Were you close with the other troopers? Yeah? You're getting emotional. What's bringing on the tears about troopers, David?
I used the word betrayal earlier. You know, some of these people were, they were family. Brothers, sisters, I loved them. Would have done anything for them. And the one moment in my life where I needed somebody to do something for me, yeah, they turned their backs on me.
Did you kill your wife and your family?
No, sir, I did not.
Right now on WLKY News at 11, gunfire, chaos, and terror on the streets of West Louisville.
That shooting did happen yesterday afternoon, just before 3 o'clock at the intersection of Bardstown Road and Goldsmith Lane.
We asked him, we go, you know, why the Turtle Man? Because I want to go off on one more adventure and I want to go with him.
Crews say the emergency is over for now. Those trains can start to be moved once the sun comes up this morning, and emergency personnel are telling us they're just happy that this situation wasn't much worse.
This is WLKY, live, local, late breaking. Your complete news coverage for Greater Louisville starts right now.
From spring-like fury to the frigidness of Old Man Winter, as tornado survivors try to pick up the pieces, they're forced to dig out from a late winter snowstorm. While the snow may conceal the destruction, It is impossible to hide the pain and the anguish many of them are feeling. Their homes, their communities, gone in a matter of seconds. Good evening to you. I'm Rick Van Hoos.
And I'm Vicki Dorch, live here in Henryville, Indiana, where two tornadoes roared through this small community of 1,900 people on Friday afternoon. As you can see behind me, the cleanup is underway here at Henryville School. They brought in the big equipment to clean that up. Over to my right, you see parts of a home still standing. Their personal items strewn all over the yard. There's a water heater, the couch, women's and men's clothing. The vacuum is standing up there. And in the tree branches that's barely hanging there, the American flag. And you see American flags hanging all over this community. The sun is shining. Cleanup is underway, as I said. And despite the fact that there are sad, sad stories here, people are sad, people are grieving. They have not given up hope here. You still see smiles on their faces. Everyone seems to be in a very great mood. They walk by, say hello, ask how we're doing, when of course we're here concerned about them. And all the stories of devastation that are going on here in Henryville, Indiana, there are some miraculous stories of survival. I met two teachers up here yesterday who were telling me the story about a mom who came to Silver Creek School to get her two kids before the storm came. She was concerned about them, wanted to take them home. They said if it had just been 10 minutes later, they were not letting kids or parents leave. They let this mom leave. She's a great mom. They like her so much. She's an outstanding woman. She takes her kids home. The storm rolls through, and she loses parts of both legs. That is the story of Stephanie Decker here. And Drew Douglas continues this story to tell us how Stephanie's two children saved her life.
Here's all the remains of the Deckers' home after the two tornadoes whipped through Henryville. Just before the devastation struck, Stephanie Decker put herself on the line for her kids. She grabbed a large comforter and wrapped them inside, and then rested herself on top of them to shield them from all the debris.
I was reaching around holding them and trying to keep everything away from them so it didn't hit them.
The wreckage that piled on Stephanie broke seven of her ribs and almost completely severed both of her legs.
I had two steel beams on my legs, and I couldn't move. I was stuck.
Decker told her 8-year-old son Dominic to make sure the coast was clear before getting help. Stephanie's fear was confirmed. A second twister was headed right for her family.
And they are screaming, "Mommy, I can't live without you. I don't want to die. Please don't let me die."
Despite being pinned down by the steel beams, Decker covered her two children a second time in the comforter. After two tornadoes, just minutes apart, leveled their home, Dominic and 5-year-old Reese didn't suffer so much as a scratch.
Anybody that knows her has no doubt that's what she'd do.
Unable to remove the heavy debris lying on top of their badly injured mother, Decker's young son went for help. The phone lines were down, so Stephanie used her cell phone for something else.
And then I took my phone and I made a video to my husband.
Hey.
Telling him I love him. And my children that I love them.
After what seemed like a lifetime, a neighbor and four others finally arrived for the 37-year-old mother writhing in pain.
He came down and I looked at him and I said, "I'm dying. You gotta save me."
Tourniquets were made to prevent her from bleeding to death. She was eventually taken to the University of Louisville Hospital, where she continues to recover. Both of her legs, casualties from the massive storm.
But if I can make it through that, I can live through anything.
Decker will have another surgery on Thursday to clean out her leg. She's optimistic she'll begin walking within the next 3 months, thanks to prosthetics. A miraculous ending among all this wreckage. In Henryville, Drew Douglas, WLKY News.
A miraculous ending it is. It's correct, Drew. A Southern Indiana community came together this afternoon to remember 5 of the 13 lives lost here in Indiana in this storm. 15-month-old Angel Babcock passed away Sunday, 2 days after an entire family was found dead near their Pekin home. Family members held a memorial service today in Salem. That's where WLKY's Jessica Oh joins us now live with the very latest. Jessica?
Vicki, the memorial service was held here at this church behind me, and this place was packed with family members and people in the community. Now, today, for the first time, we talked to a family member. We met her in New Pekin, Indiana today. She told us how devastating it was to lose so much family in a matter of seconds.
I haven't slept since then.
The situation's nothing short of a nightmare for Ajayla Broff. Her sister Mariah's entire family was killed after a tornado threw them from a mobile home into the air. The parents, Mariah and Joseph, were found dead. So were two of their children, Jaden and Kendall. The family's lone survivor was a 15-month-old girl named Angel, who died 2 days after she was found.
It's a nightmare. Everybody's just traumatized and can't even believe it happened.
On top of the trauma, Jayla and close family friend Rainey Brudine say they're haunted by another thought. The two were supposed to pick the Babcocks up before the tornado hit, but they couldn't make it.
I didn't get her here in time to get her sister and nieces and nephews.
But the feelings of guilt are overcome by grief, not only for the family, but for many in the community who said their goodbyes with a heavy heart.
It's heart-wrenching. It's something you'll never forget.
Because nothing like this has happened before.
It's just affected the whole community because everybody's so close-knit.
And family members say they plan on holding a candlelight vigil on Friday, and it'll be held in New Pekin, Indiana, where the family lived. Reporting live in Salem, Indiana, I'm Jessica Oh, WLKY News.
All right, thanks a lot, Jessica. Another sad, sad story from this devastation. You can hear the backhoe behind me here at Henryville School as they clean up. It's been a sunny day after the snow fell this morning, and folks have been able to get a few things cleaned up. The snow didn't seem to cause too much damage. I'm standing in some mud here, but actually the ground is not as bad as I thought it was going to be when I came up here earlier. Eric King has been here all day, and he's going to tell us how some college students found a way to get in and to lend a helping hand. Eric, we've got so many people asking us what they can do.
I know, and that's one of the things that's overwhelming this community. It's kind of a double-edged sword. So many people want to come in and do things. These college students, they've got everything else in the world to do. They could be spending time with their friends, but they just randomly decided that they wanted to come here and help. I do want to show you something before we go to the story. Obviously, this storm was very strong, but this is a sheet of metal. I have no idea what it actually is. It's completely wrapped around the tree, and using all the force that I have in my right arm, I can't pull it off behind me. You would never think that that would be the good news. This house, it's still standing. Others, obviously, not so lucky.
Oh, this could be my home. I could have lost everything, but I was fortunate enough not to. But I'm standing where someone probably about 4 days ago got up, had breakfast, you know, called someone, lived, and now it's gone.
The woman who lived here survived.
She was in a bathtub, I believe, and something had fallen over top of her that sheltered her from, like, all the bricks and everything, and it was really scary for her, but she made it through all this, so.
These two ladies are sophomores at the University of Louisville. They've never met her in person. Today, with snow on the ground and only a fire to keep them warm, they've joined the effort to help clean up.
She is so thankful to be alive, and she's just really thankful for all the help. It's really heavy to carry a lot of the bricks and move some of the broken glass around. It's kind of difficult, but just knowing that you're doing a good cause, it helps you get through everything. And
I think it's fair to say that most of us have struggled in trying to describe this. The word debris comes up fairly often. It almost seems mean to call it that. Debris implies almost that it's garbage. In reality, these are people's belongings, things that accent their lives.
It's definitely a humbling experience. Seeing all of this really put things in perspective.
It's really difficult to think about just how this is somebody's room.
And as you get a shot of what's left of the snow here, that's obviously been a big part of the story today. It's hard to put all of this together. This is just odd in so many ways. F4 tornado on Friday, snowstorm on Monday, and now the snow is gone as fast as it came. Vicki, before I send it back to you, I'll tell you real quickly, power is still out in most of the city. It's intermittent. There's a lot of power trucks that have been coming up and down the street, so hopefully they'll be able to get that taken care of very soon. You mentioned back in our 5 o'clock hour that you can see a water tower. I'm on the other side of that water tower. I can see it too. I'm not going to push you there because we'd be shooting directly into the sun, but had you not told me that originally most of the people who live here were not able to see that because it was surrounded by trees, Vicki, I would not have believed you.
Really? Because it's so prominent right now in the city, isn't it, Eric? You can see it so well now. It's hard to believe they didn't know it was there.
Can see it plain as day.
All right, thanks a lot, Eric. Great job you're doing. Thank you so much. We're at 6 o'clock, a little after 6 here. Curfew began at 6, 6 to 6. They're not letting folks in. The traffic has died down somewhat on the main thoroughfare that I can see in front of me here. I can see the moon in the sky. Darkness is about to fall here at Henryville, so that means the cleanup will stop for the evening, but they'll be well back underway tomorrow. And as Jay Cardosi tells us, some good news with that is going to be that the temperatures are going to be warmer. We're going to see some sunshine, and maybe some folks can get some stuff done. FEMA's going to be here tomorrow. They're telling us water should be back onto most all of the area within the 2 days. And, of course, power, as Eric said, they're still working little by little, inch by inch, to get that back on. It'll be a couple of weeks. But southern Indiana wasn't the only area hit by these tornadoes. Rick, Kentucky was hit as well.
Yes, and hit hard as well. 12 counties in Kentucky declared disaster areas. It was in the south, the north, and off to the east, Vicki, the damage in those pictures that you've been bringing us. Thanks so much for that. Several parts of Kentucky took a direct hit from the storm. A look at the recovery effort there. That's next in 1 minute on WLKY. And the National Weather Service has now confirmed an EF3 tornado hit Milton, Kentucky, in Trimble County. The twister was more than 75 yards wide and traveled about 3.5 miles. Now, that's a tornado with winds of about 150 miles an hour. It snapped and twisted trees before directly striking the Milton Volunteer Fire Station. That's on Highway 421. Witnesses described it as a narrow skipping tornado that moved from trailers and cars, damaged two homes, and then took out an electrical transmission line. A total of 22 people were killed in the storm in Kentucky, many of them in the eastern part of the state. One tornado threw portions of Menifee, Morgan, Johnson, and Lawrence counties. The twister that hit West Liberty, I have a cousin that lives there, was on the ground for about 60 miles. Described as a war zone by Governor Beshear, it demolished the downtown there and tore up neighborhoods. Authorities still are not letting people in or out of the town. Crews hope power is restored by tomorrow. There were nearly four dozen tornadoes reported across Kentucky and Indiana. Chief Meteorologist Jay Cardosi is here now to give us an idea of the strength and the length of these storms. And Jay, we're used to these skipping tornadoes.
Right,
what
right.
fueled these to just grind away on the ground like this?
The environmental conditions were absolutely perfect for these large, we call them wedge tornadoes. Those are about the strongest tornadoes that you can get. Typically, you hear about these things out in the central plains, or like they had down south in Alabama and Mississippi last year. Well, Friday afternoon, those conditions were perfect over us. So the winds that fed these storms were so strong, it kept these tornadoes just going for long periods of time on the ground. This was Friday's tornado path, as you can see. It actually originated way out in Illinois and then worked its way off towards the east and also the northeast, on the ground for dozens and dozens of miles. Now, you see that yellow line. This is when the storm really intensified and took over EF4 damage characteristics. In other words, winds were up to 170 miles per hour from near Pekin through Henryville over to Nab, Chelsea, and then up through Milton. And then the storm moved farther off to the east, northeast as well. And we can't forget these images right here. Pekin, that dark, menacing funnel cloud touching down, expanding and really becoming quite violent as it worked off towards the east, northeast. Into the Henryville area is a multiple vortex tornado. That is little miniature tornadoes, violent little miniature tornadoes, rotating around the parent tornado as everything moves along. Those are extremely dangerous, and that's what happened in portions of southern Indiana. But this was a widespread event, not only the Ohio Valley, but all the way off to the south. 632 total reports of severe weather. Of those, 107 were tornado reports, most concentrated right here in the Ohio and Tennessee valleys. In Indiana and Kentucky alone, including southern Indiana, out towards the eastern portions of the state, off to the south of Louisville included, 46 tornado reports Friday afternoon and Friday evening. Rick, to say the least, we'd like to forget that day, but I'll tell you what, it's going to be sketched in our memory for quite some time. The forecast is much calmer. We're going to have that for you coming up in just a couple of minutes.
Your live, local, late-breaking coverage for Greater Louisville continues right now.
A 10-year-old girl is recovering at Cozer Children's Hospital tonight after Metro Animal Services says she was attacked by a pit bull. WLKY's Ann Bowden joins us now with the latest details on this investigation in this case. Ann?
Well, Rick, the owner of the dog is now charged, but it's 8-month-old Playa, or the pit bull, who is behind bars. And a 10-year-old girl still has a chip of his tooth in her chin.
She's got stitches all on her face. She had bite marks all up her arms and everything.
Just before 7 Sunday night, EMS and Metro Animal Services got a call of a dog attack in the 1200 block of South 16th Street. When they arrived, a 10-year-old girl was bloodied and bitten with deep wounds to her face, neck, and arms.
They were very severe injuries.
According to Metro Animal Services, this 8-month-old pit bull named Playa attacked the 10-year-old girl. For her privacy, her family has asked that her name not be released. According to the report, the girl was playing with the children next door who had just recently moved in. As they played, the new neighbor's pit bull puppy, chained on the front porch, started to get agitated. So the neighbors brought him in. But as the children continued to play, family says the pit bull broke through the front door of the house and attacked the 10-year-old, first grabbing her face and pulling her to the ground, then grabbing her arm and dragging her further.
They think that these pit bulls, they think if they raise them right, they're not going to turn on a kid. You never know. It only takes a split second.
Now the mother and other family members of the 10-year-old wait at Cozair Children's Hospital as she recovers from bite wounds that x-rays show have literally left their mark.
And they said there was a little white speck, probably a piece of a tooth or something, but it wasn't hitting no arteries or nothing, so she wouldn't have to have surgery.
But Playa's future is uncertain.
You know, it's unfortunate that this happened with a pit bull, because they always get this dangerous name. But at the same time, regardless if this was a Chihuahua, pit bull, Labrador, Retriever, we would handle the investigation exactly the same.
Right now, the dog is being evaluated and checked for rabies. Playa will be observed for 10 days, and no decisions will be made until after that time. The dog's owner was charged with possession of a potentially dangerous animal. Ann Bowden, WLKY News.
Now, your WLKY weather with Chief Meteorologist Jay Cardoso.
Hi, folks. Hope you had a great day. Boy, that's not a great view right there at all, is it? Live pictures coming in from the WLKY News chopper, a very hard-hit area. That's Henryville, Indiana, just being devastated by last Friday's tornado and EF4 winds up to 170 miles per hour. And this was the type of damage that happened in Pekin, the type of damage that happened in Knapp, the type of damage that happened in Chelsea, and then up in Milton as well. It was just a nightmarish scene. It continues to be that way. Lots of cleanup. It's going to take quite some time to get back to normal, but I'll tell you what, this is the one community that's going to do just that, get back to normal and do it quickly as well. All right, as far as the weather conditions are concerned, the good news, the snow, the rain, the thunderstorm activity the last 5-7 days, finally, it's out of here. But you realize we had 3.7 inches of snow officially in Louisville last night through the early morning hours, making it the biggest snowfall of the season so far. How about that? And that coming after all those devastating storms last week. That snowmaker is now well off to the east of us. The skies are clearing. The snow that is out there is beginning to melt. Still some snow on the ground in metro Louisville and points off to the east and also the north. Other locations that had about an inch or so, that's already gone. But there's still some snow on the ground that saw, you know, amounts of 2, 3, 4 inches. High pressure is now in control. So for the first half of this night, where there is some snow on the ground, those temps are going to drop pretty rapidly and then should steady out. Right now, 36 degrees in town, 30s off towards the north-northeast. But there you go. Starting to warm again off to our west-southwest, back into the 50s, and that's the air on the move. That's the air that's going to be here by tomorrow afternoon. If anything, going to be a little bit milder than the 50s for your Tuesday afternoon. Mid-30s across the board right now. That humidity is 57% with a west breeze in here, right around 6 miles per hour. All right, here we go. Tomorrow morning, a clear, chilly start to your day. High pressure moves off to the east, and by afternoon, we really start to pick up a south breeze. And with lots of sunshine, those temperatures will start to elevate after that chilly start. So no doubt, if there is still some snow in your backyard, it will likely be gone by midday or early afternoon tomorrow. Look at the highs on your Tuesday. Upper 50s across southern portions of Indiana with 60s, low 60s from Louisville and points off to the south and southwest. And isn't this a pretty picture? a sight for sore eyes, so to speak. Look off to the west. Not much happening. It looks like we'll hold on to nice, mild, and clear weather as we move on into Wednesday as well. Here are the details of the forecast. Clear skies, chilly as we drop to near 30 the next few hours and even 30 at 10 o'clock tonight. By tomorrow morning, we'll wake up to 27 underneath clear skies. Midday, lots of sunshine. Temperatures will zoom up to 50 as south winds kick in. Your high 62 tomorrow afternoon, 68 Wednesday. Chance for showers moves in Thursday night, especially late day Thursday night into Friday morning. Better chance for a few showers and storms later in the weekend, but those do not look to be severe right now. So kind of quieter as we move throughout the week.
Certainly. That's what we need for the cleanup efforts. All right, thank you, Jay. Well, Fred Talks Tournament's next.
Live with Fred Calgill, this is WLKY Sports.
Hello again, everybody. Wednesday night at 7 in New York City, U of L basketball's in a Big East tournament second round game against either Providence or Seton Hall. Louisville's got a formidable job ahead trying to turn around its shooting problems virtually overnight after losing a fourth game and six tries last Saturday at Syracuse. That's dropped the Cards out of both major polls after spending virtually the entire winter there. You want to be playing your best basketball in March, not your worst, but Peyton Siva says don't give up on the Cards.
Hey, you know, like I said, you know, everybody could say what they want. They could write us off, but, oh, well, who cares? Like I said, you know, we all we got. We got us, Coach P, and the coaching staff. You know, Lord, watch over us, but, you know, we'll go out there and bat our ass off.
And the next game for UK basketball is an SEC tournament quarterfinal Friday in New Orleans. Kentucky's records are 30-1 and 16-0. Just a third perfect league season in over a half century after beating Florida yesterday. Number one this week again in both major polls. A projected top overall seed in the NCAA tournament on Selection Sunday. This Sunday night with live coverage right here on WLKY Metasports.
So they head to New Orleans. Maybe that's a tune-up. They want to be there in New Orleans on April or what, the first?
Yeah, something the like first Monday, 4 weeks from tonight for the championship game. They can leave some clothes there because they're probably going back.
All right. Yeah. Thank you for making us your first choice for news. The CBS Evening News is next. We'll see you back here tonight at 11.
Thanks for watching, and be sure to find us on Facebook. To post your comments and join discussions, click the Facebook link at WLKY.com.